We will now move on to the next item of business, which is Stage 3 proceedings on the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is Scottish Parliament Bill 13A, the marshalled list and the groupings of amendments. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for around 5 minutes for the first division of the Stage 3 debate. The period of voting for the first division will be 45 seconds, and then thereafter I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press their request to speak buttons or enter request to speak, RTS, in the chat function as soon as possible after I call the group, and members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. And we move to Group 1, applications by 16 and 17-year-olds. I call Amendment 6 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, group with amendments as shown in the groupings. I draw members' attention to the procedural information relating to this group as set out in the groupings, and I point out that if Amendment 9 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 10 due to a preemption, and if Amendment 12 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 101, again due to a preemption. Rachel Hamilton to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move amendment in my name. As drafted, the Gender Recognition Reform Bill would lower the age at which an individual could apply to obtain a gender recognition certificate to 16. Amendments 6, 7, 8, 9 and 12 in this group seek to keep the minimum age at which someone can apply for a GRC, which is a gender recognition certificate, at 18. In Scotland, an individual under the age of 18 is not considered old enough to stand for election in this Parliament, nor can they serve as a juror, place a bet, buy or sell alcohol, get a tattoo or be permitted to watch certain films at the cinema. As with obtaining a gender recognition certificate, I would agree that there is good reason for this. Earlier this month, the Parliament held a debate on Human Rights Day in which the Scottish Government's intent to incorporate the UNCRC into domestic law. The UNCRC defines anyone under the age of 18 as a child. Moreover, the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee heard from Susan Smith when taking evidence on this bill that people do not cognitively mature until 25. This contention is also outlined in Scottish prison sentencing guidelines, yet as drafted, this bill would confer the rights alongside the great burden of responsibility of applying for a gender recognition certificate upon individuals as young as 16. Worse still, it would... Yes.
Alex Cole Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Rachel Hamilton for giving way. If I'm called later, Presiding Officer, I will talk to the age of majority and the significant, well, the number of variances that exist around age of majority in Scots law. But Rachel Hamilton and her group backed the Age of Criminal Responsibility Bill, which set the age of mental capacity for children in terms of being held responsible for their actions and their crimes at 12, 2 years below the de minimis set by the international community. Does Rachel Hamilton recognise that age is not a guarantor of wisdom, that actually 16 is the age at which most things in Scotland are now consolidating, and certainly if we can credit 12-year-olds with the capacity to commit crimes, we can certainly credit 16-year-olds with having the capacity necessary to understand their identity and apply for recognition of the same.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank Alex Hall-Hamilton for that intervention. I don't think he's comparing like with like of the capacity of age of criminal responsibility and obtaining a gender recognition certificate. And moreover, the Scottish Government's own equality impact assessment actually states that they need more up-to-date research because they need to collect the data on the impact of the mental well-being of young people. So I think it's really important that Scottish Government's own impact assessment doesn't even back up their own argument. But thank you for your intervention. The relevance of cognitive maturity, the capacity of children to change, and the conference of such a great responsibility on children seems worryingly misguided in this bill as drafted. Group after group, expert after expert, and even an Irish senator, generally in favour of these reforms, spoke out against lowering the age in committee sessions. And last night we heard from Rima Salem, who will also make her opinion known on to the Scottish Government on the lowering of age, but she hasn't yet had the opportunity to do so. Despite all of this evidence, when I brought these amendments to the committee at stage two, the Cabinet Secretary rejected them on the basis of an anecdote. And does she believe that her opinion, based on that, is more valuable than the views of experts who gave evidence in committee, or indeed 81% of Scottish public who were polled on the topic of lowering the age to 16 who thought that this was a bad idea? Children who are struggling with gender identity need this government to support them, not to place a burden of responsibility upon them. That support could be provided in two ways, by gaining a better understanding of their experience and by improving provision of services. Dr. Hilary Cass's review into gender services provided this Parliament with a golden opportunity to improve our understanding and gain clarity on how we can improve services. Yet it has been completely ignored, whilst this legislation was needlessly railroaded through Parliament. And don't Scottish children deserve the same level of care and safeguarding as those south of the border? I find it extraordinary that the CAS review was not taken into account. The interim report from the independent CAS review has led to the closure of the Tavistock Clinic in London, a move supported by the EHRC but ignored by the Scottish Government. The Cabinet Secretary has continued to play down the relevance of such an intervention in line with her policy of shutting down any conversation that may prolong the scrutiny applied to this bill. In responding to these amendments, would the Cabinet Secretary explain why she believes that warnings from an independent review of child gender services in the UK are not linked to children obtaining a gender recognition certificate in Scotland? And does she believe that accessing gender services for children would have no bearing on their decision to apply to change their gender? And should we continue to ignore the opportunity to implement recommendations for improving these services before passing this bill? Concerned clinicians have yet to hear a single justification from this government as to why they have chosen to ignore evidence that is deemed worrying enough to close down services in the South. On this point, I fully appreciate the sentiment behind Claire Baker's amendments in this group. However, the fundamental issue of lowering the age at which an individual can obtain a GRC remains a sticking point, particularly for me, on which I cannot support these amendments for the reasons I've set out already. And in the same vein, I understand the reasoning behind Amendment 15 from Kenny Gibson, which ensures that applicants under the age of 18 must seek advice from someone such as a medical professional. Amendments 98 and 101 from Jamie Green, which requires young applicants to be able to provide evidence that they have sought advice regarding obtaining a GRC. Amendment 99 from Christine Graham, which requires young applicants to provide to the Register General what role the individual who is giving guidance to the applicant plays. It is vital that safeguards, in my opinion, remain in place in order to make this bill workable. And I absolutely appreciate that these amendments seek to introduce further safeguards for under-18s applying for a gender recognition certificate. However, they are fundamentally underpinned by an acceptance that people under the age of 18 should be enabled to obtain a GRC. That we are having a discussion about the need for extra safeguards for this particular group of people is an admission that there are concerns about this. I would urge these members who are concerned to consider the arguments I have set out as to why now is not the time to extend the ability to obtain a GRC to children under 18. And Jackie Bailey's Amendment 105 similarly relies on this acceptance, although I understand that it comes from a position of attempting to clear up a potential loophole that would allow people even younger than 16 to begin the process of obtaining a GRC. Nonetheless, this amendment stumbles on the same sticking point of making allowances for under-18s to apply for a gender recognition certificate. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Claire Baker to speak to Amendment 93 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've introduced Amendments 93 and 94 to raise the issues identified in Dr. Hilary Cass's interim review into gender identity services for children and young people in NHS England. I believe it is worth highlighting these issues in the context of the proposal to lower the age from 18 to 16 at which someone can gain a GRC in Scotland. The interim report recognises that social transition is not a neutral act and may lead to young people taking a medicalised pathway. Acquiring a GRC is a potent form of social transition. And while it's often stated that it is not a passport to clinical services, it would be an indicator that would strengthen the case for medical intervention. The Stage 1 report from the Equalities Committee does include consideration of the CAS interim review and asks that the Scottish Government consider a full review into gender identity healthcare. It would be helpful to know if the Scottish Government intends to do so. There is little research or analysis of the increase in young people seeking to transition, a point made by the CAS report, which highlighted persisting evidence gaps and areas of uncertainty. While I recognise the CAS review is looking at services in England, it does raise concerns that we should take into consideration. The interim review says that there has not been routine and consistent data collection, which means it is not possible to accurately track the outcomes and pathways that children and young people take through the service. There's a lack of consensus and open discussion about the nature of gender dysmorphia. The mix of young people presenting to the service is more complex than seen previously, with many being neurodiverse and or having a wide range of psychosocial and mental health needs. The largest group currently comprises birth-registered females first presenting in adolescence with gender-related distress. Primary and secondary care staff report feeling under pressure to adopt an unquestioning affirmation approach. Concerns over diagnostic overshadowing. Many of the children and young people presenting have complex needs, but once they're identified as having gender-related distress, other important healthcare issues that would normally be managed by local services can sometimes be overlooked. So these amendments are calling for a pause. It is asking for time to reflect on the emerging evidence on services for children and young people, but also to consider the reasons behind a high proportion of young women applying. A pause would not prevent any 16 or 17-year-old socially transitioning. They can change the vast majority of documents they have. Their school, college or university have policies to support social transition. A birth certificate is rarely needed as identification. And as Scottish Trans highlighted in a briefing to MSPs last week, it is not a legal requirement to provide universities or employers with birth certificates. This is also the case if we were to retain the age of 18. As someone who has brought forward amendments at Stage 2 and who was a member of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs Committee, which scrutinised the Census Bill, I have held many discussions and meetings on this bill and have worked hard to understand the arguments while being prepared to question and scrutinise some assumptions and assertions that are being made. I am asking for caution. The CAS interim review has raised important issues around safeguarding, and I don't think it is unreasonable to pause a reduction in the age to 16 and take full cognizance of emerging evidence and concerns.
Thank you. I call Jamie Green to speak to Amendment 98 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first of all put on record my thanks to the many organisations and individuals who have sent members' briefings. I know these take a lot of time and a lot of effort has gone into them. In particular, can I thank the Stonewall Group, LGBT Youth Scotland, Amnesty International, the Equality Network, more recently the Equality and Human Rights Commission Scotland, and also Blackburn Mackenzie Murray. And whilst amongst these organisations they may not all agree with me or indeed each other, I think it's important to respect that there is a difference of opinions on many of the amendments that we will debate today, and I do thank them for their efforts. My two amendments in this group, to be followed by a third anomaly which we'll come on to, is around the applications by 16 and 17-year-olds. Now, I do understand and appreciate that this is one of the fundamental changes that the bill does. It does reduce the age from its current age in the 2004 Act from 18 to 16. Throughout Stage 2, a number of amendments which actually gathered cross-party support were accepted, and I did feel that there was room for improvement on those for many of the reasons that I believe Rachel Hamilton has also given. As drafted at the moment in the bill that we have before we amend it today, Section 3.8 talks about guidance, advice and support for young applicants. This is a new section that was added at Stage 2. I think it's a welcome addition. But at present it states that the applicant must simply confirm to the Registrar General that the applicant has discussed the implications for the applicant of obtaining a GRC with an individual. It then goes on to list two criteria of which who that individual should be. My Amendment 98 provides that when confirming to the Register General that they have discussed their application with a suitable individual, an applicant aged 16 or 17-year-old must also be able to provide reasonable evidence of that discussion if requested so. Amendment 98 adds no further criteria as to whom the person must have that conversation with, nor does it put unnecessary barriers in place. It simply allows for the Registrar General to request evidence that this conversation has indeed taken place. Just one second. I will talk first on Amendment 101, which is a follow-on from that. That then provides that when granting an application to a 16 or 17-year-old, the Registrar General must be satisfied that the applicant has received appropriate guidance, advice and support as detailed in Section 3A. The Registrar General may reject the application if he or she is not satisfied about this. I'm happy to give way.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the member for taking the intervention. Just in relation to Amendment 98, I'm interested to know what Jamie Green means by the phrase "be able to provide reasonable evidence," because there's a danger in any legislation that we insert phrases like that that are potentially quite woolly legally. So I'm not sure what that means, but if the member could tell us, that would be useful.
Jamie Green.
I think the member makes a fair point. And if the benefit of, had we had more time to discuss these amendments, this would have been an excellent addition to make. This is an amendment which could easily have been tidied up with more succinct language. I'm of the understanding that colleagues on these benches will likely oppose these amendments for simply not going far enough in terms of support and guidance, and the government benches will oppose them because they think they go too far. So I'm somewhat stuck in the middle of this conundrum. But you know, that the member does make a fair point, and I have been uncomfortable with the rate and speed at which we have to address these amendments. And for that reason, I will listen carefully to arguments that are made, and indeed the response from the government, of which I hope will contain some legal feedback on the wording of my amendments. But the premise of them really is simply to try and go a step further to how the bill is currently drafted, to provide some extra comfort and safeguards that young people are getting appropriate advice. Martin Whitfield's Amendment 25 in this space does something similar, and I'm sure we'll hear more about that in due course. As does Amendment 15 from Kenny Gibson. But on all the amendments in this group, there is a common theme, and there are two things that some of these amendments introduce with which I'm comfortable. The first is the reintroduction of the concept of the medicalisation of the process, something which the bill itself seeks to remove. It is contrary, in my view, to the general principles of the bill, general principles that I do support. And the other are simply amendments that seek to revert to the status quo and that of 18 years of age. Again, it's no secret that's not a position I would agree with. I have one further amendment in this group that I will speak to when called on behalf of another member who's unable to be here today, so I'll reserve further comments until that point. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Call Martin Whitfield to speak to Amendment 24 and other amendments in the group.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to follow Jamie Green. And can I echo his thanks to those outside of this chamber who have provided suggestions, advice and indeed commentary. Much effort has been spent in engagement with people over this bill, and although I'm not in agreement with some of it, I can thank all of them for reaching out, because that is our role within this place, to listen to our constituents. I intend to speak to Amendment 24 and three others. Amendment 24 is really just a technical amendment that paves the way for 25, which has already been mentioned by Jamie Green, and indeed builds to a certain extent, or sits as a complement to the previous amendment that we've heard, and it seeks merely for the individual that young person has spoken to be named, to be identified and addressed, to contact them. I don't think that this is a huge reach forward or in a reach into something that shouldn't be protected or unknown. It is right that young people take their time to make decisions, and there's been interesting arguments already expressed in this chamber about moving the age to 18, which I can't find agreement with. Here in Scotland, we support our young people throughout their time to make increasing decisions about themselves, and they do so with a scaffolding that sits around them, not to influence those decisions, but to protect them where those decisions are made, to give advice where it's sought. And I think that this, identifying the person, or indeed people or organisations that have been spoken to, is a reasonable step to show that those discussions have taken place and that those discussions were appropriate. I understand, having had discussions with the government, for which I thank them, that there is some steps over the fact that it should be a conversation rather than a written record. I have to say, all my amendment seeks is to identify the name and contact address of that individual. It's not to go behind that into the discussion that's been had, because on many levels I can understand the confidentiality that needs to exist for those discussions to take place properly. Indeed, for a young person to reach out to a trusted adult, there first has to be that trust. More than happy to.
Tess White.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child Incorporation Bill defines children as persons under the age of 18. Does the member agree that 16 and 17-year-olds are still children? Thank you.
Martin Whitfield.
Here in Scotland, young people are aged 16 and 17, and I accept the wording of the UNCRC. And what that seeks to do is to reinforce both the protections that exist for children, but also as a vehicle for young people to question decisions that are made about them that do not encompass or indeed hold up their human rights. And I very much look forward to that point where we can hear from the government as to when that comes back to this Parliament, where we can indeed fully and properly debate it. So, to return to amendments 24 and 25, I believe these are small steps forward that would reinforce confidence both for the young person and those that are around them to say, who was it that you spoke to, provide their name or indeed names if it is an organisation, and contact. It does not seek to impinge on any discussions that happens. It's certainly not inviting a young person to share the details of those discussions or indeed risk criminalising them for doing so in error. This is merely asking for factual information that I believe is reasonable to give. The other two amendments in my name, presiding officer, are 26 and 37. Again, 26 has the benefit of being a tiny technical amendment that facilitates 37 coming forward. And in this one, the proposed amendment addresses the concerns about the capacity of 16 to 18-year-olds to apply for a certificate or indeed to understand the implications of possessing a certificate. It would allow a Registrar General to reject an application if they were not satisfied that the person was capable of understanding the effect of the certificate or indeed the importance of a statutory declaration. The Registrar General is additionally obliged to reject an application if they suspect the young person is under any kind of coercion into applying for one. In law, young people aged 16 and over are presumed to have capacity, and that is right. But if we liken this to decisions that can also be made by young people of that age here in Scotland, consent to, refusal of, treatment in their own right, indeed refusing access to medical records should they choose, we must respect that consent. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her meeting and letter that took place on the 8th of December, and in particular paragraph 6, to quote, turning to my own amendment 60, also agreed by the committee at stage 2, this introduced a new power for the Registrar General to apply to a sheriff on the grounds that the GRC application was fraudulent or that the applicant was incapable of understanding the effect of obtaining a GRC or of validly making the application. If the Cabinet Secretary is content to confirm this on the record today, and that the Registrar General, if they felt the young person lacked the understanding as to the effect of obtaining a certificate, and that there is a vehicle open to the Registrar General, then I am minded not to push that, these two amendments on that point. Can I thank you for your time, Presiding Officer?
Thank you. I call Kenneth Gibson to speak to Amendment 15 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and for reasons of brevity, I'll speak to only two amendments. My own Amendment 15, which I move, and which simply seeks to strengthen Section 3A and Amendment 6. The bill seeks to demedicalise self-ID transition, and this amendment strikes a balance between that aim and the need for effective counselling, a move I consider to be vital. After all, these days, young people are encouraged to be counselled even when they pass, even if they fail an exam. The person to provide such advice should be clarified in guidance, be suitably qualified and could be a medical practitioner. However, it should not be a parent or teacher unless such a person is qualified to give counselling advice. Were deemed necessary by the council, the young person concerned could be referred to a suitable clinician. The CAST review states that, and I quote, the mix of young people presenting to the service is more complex than seen previously, with many being neurodiverse and or having a wide range of psychosocial and mental health needs. And the view goes on to say that once identified as having gender-related distress, other important healthcare issues that would normally be managed by local services can sometimes be overlooked. Clinicians should remain open and explore the patient's experience and the range of support and treatment options that may best address their needs. Well, the CAST review may focus on England. Is the experience of young people with gender distress here in Scotland any different? I think not. A senior child psychiatrist told the Guardian newspaper that in the last 5 to 10 years, they have seen a huge surge in young women who want to become boys. They've changed their name and are keen to have hormones or puberty blockers, a development that often follows social transition represented by a GRC. The psychiatrist said that often these girls are children going through their normal identity and developmental problems with adolescence and finding the solutions for themselves in this way. There's Kurt, happy to take an intervention.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you. I'm just a bit confused. The member seems to be concerned about demedicalisation and also the current medicalisation. Does he not recognise that demedicalisation will decouple the two issues and perhaps allow young people to explore whether or not they even want to pursue medical transition?
Kenneth Gibson.
At all, in fact. Indeed, I'm of the view that with proper counselling, it may be that they do have to seek a clinician, but the point about counselling is they do not have to go down that road. That's why, as I said, I'm trying to strike a balance between both positions that have been expressed so far today. Now, there's currently no consensus among clinicians about the matter, and parents have differing explanations for what might have prompted their child's gender uncertainty. Bayswater Support represents the parents of roughly 500 trans adolescents. Members often describe their child's trans identity as overshadowing other factors, including neurodevelopmental conditions such as autism and ADHD, social factors like bullying and not fitting in with their peers, emerging same-sex attraction, poor mental health and often puberty itself. Other parents believe the hypersexualisation of the female body, fueled by the representation of women in popular TV programmes and on social media, and a child's early understanding of sexism make them feel it may be easier to live as a male than as a woman. Transitioning was once predominantly undertaken by middle-aged men, now it's teenage girls. Earlier experience of sexual assault can play an important role. Detransitioner Sinead Watson, who returned to living as a woman after identifying as a man for 7 years, said she was repeatedly sexually assaulted in her teens and felt hatred towards her female body. A 2020 study in the peer-reviewed academic journal Clinical Child Psychology and Psychiatry found that the degree of social transition did not significantly predict psychological functioning outcomes in a clinical sample of children with a gender dysphoria diagnosis. It claims that gender affirmation through transitioning socially is beneficial for children with gender dysphoria and could not be supported from present results. Instead, the study highlights the importance of individual social support provided by peers and family, independent of exploring additional possibilities of gender transition during counselling. For some people, a pathway towards social and later medical and or surgical transition may be the right option. However, the examples I gave show that for some young people, this is just a transient phase and a manifestation of other conditions, experiences or circumstances in the young person's life. I therefore believe my amendment will provide trans adolescents and parents with extra support to help them explore potential reasons for their gender nonconformity. And where necessary, this will ensure that no other important underlying healthcare issues or conditions young people with gender distress have is overlooked. So I would ask members to support Amendment 15. With regard to Amendment 6, I recall reading very recently, as other members will have done, that on New Year's Day 2020, a 15-year-old boy was killed by a 22-year-old hit-and-run speeding driver in Wishaw whilst walking to his grandparents' house. His killer, who had previous convictions for speeding and careless driving, avoided a custodial sentence because sentencing guidelines suggest the brain is not fully developed until the age of 25, and a young person will generally have a lower level of maturity with a greater capacity for change than an older person. Yet this bill proposes to lower the age at which one can legally be perceived to have transitioned from 18 to 16. And yes, you can marry at 16 and vote in some elections and drive at 17, but one can't buy alcohol or cigarettes before the age of 18. Our society is inconsistent. Well, considering this bill, we must at all times ensure the welfare of the child or young person is paramount, and at the centre of this often fraught debate are children, adolescents and their loved ones, who are often in great distress. No one today is arguing that gender dysphoria doesn't exist. However, as a number of children who believe themselves to mean the wrong gender rises exponentially amidst reports of teenage peer cluster effects, we must be cautious about who is recognised socially to have transitioned. Why? Because it will increase the likelihood they will receive puberty blockers, cross-sex hormones and perhaps surgery. Actions which a gender recognition certificate can only accelerate. Dr. Hilary Cass's review states that regarding a GRC, it's, and I quote, important to view it as an active intervention because it may have significant effects on the child or young person in terms of their psychological functioning. At primary, secondary and specialist level, there is a lack of agreement about the extent to which gender incongruence in childhood and adolescence can be an inherent and immutable phenomenon for which transition is the best option for the individual, or a more fluid and temporal response to a range of developmental, social and psychological factors. And a 2020 study by Siever et al. In the peer-reviewed academic journal Clinical Child Psychology and Psychiatry defines social transition as often the first possibility to align with one's experienced gender and live in the preferred gender role, different from that at birth in almost all aspects of life. Irreversibility is of fundamental concern. Despite our different views on this bill, we can surely all agree that a gender recognition certificate leads 16 and 17-year-olds on a pathway of social transition at the very least. However, the Hippocratic Oath is quite clear. First, do no harm. As elected representatives, we too should pursue that philosophy. Social transition followed potentially by the prescribing of hormones to young people, which can have short and long-term side effects in themselves, encourages those who might not ultimately pursue full transition on a path leading not only to profound regret, but sterility, anorgasmia and long-term health issues. As I'm happy to give way.
Stephen Kerr.
I just feel prompted to intervene to say that I think the member and I attended a meeting organised by one of his colleagues, Ruth Maguire. I have to say that I found that to be one of the most moving experiences that I've had in a very long time, to sit in a room with two young people who were expressing profound distress, goes far beyond regret, and I certainly felt that I couldn't agree more with what the member is saying on the basis just of those two young people, and I know they were representative of many others who have gone down a path and then found it impossible to come back up that path.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you for that, Mr Kerr. As you know, I was also present at that very moving and at times quite distressing meeting, listening to these experiences. And now, as for surgery, that should only be contemplated after serious consideration and counselling. Now, some people know their own minds, it was said in the stage two, but of course some don't, and we have to protect the most vulnerable of these young people. So allowing more time for reflection on this life-changing decision is important if we are not to experience an upsurge in ruined lives. People who regret becoming trans, with all that means, who then later seek to detransition. Allowing transition at 18 will still give those who do wish to proceed decades in their new identity. I believe it will also save many from the misery of making a decision too early in life from which they are unable to turn the clock back. As detransitioner Richie Herron told a number of us last month, it's a one-way ticket. I can't grow my genitals back. Colleagues, we're divided into those who genuinely support the bill, those opposed, and those who may be undecided on the bill itself and the amendments. Others, for understandable reasons of loyalty, trust and their ambition, plan to vote as advised by their whip. But please think primarily of the young people concerned, those who might be confused, have underlying neurodiverse or mental health conditions, and support Amendment 6 to give those young people time and space to grow, mature and be better able to take the right decision.
Thank you. I call Jamie Green to speak to Amendment 99 on behalf of Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I appreciate this is a somewhat unusual, perhaps unorthodox way of speaking to and moving amendments, but I'll do my best. The reason for this, as members may know, is that Ms Graham is unwell and cannot be here today, but there were a lot of similarities in what she was proposing to do and my previous amendments, which I hitherto spoke to. I'm moving Amendment 99 because I do feel that there is a compromise therein. The amendment provides that for when confirming to a registrar general that an applicant aged 16 or 17-year-old has discussed their application with a suitable individual, such applicant must also tell the registrar general what role that individual has and how they know them. Now, this is a step beyond what was agreed at stage two. The initial amendment proposed by Christine Graham, members who were involved in stage two will be aware, was supported by my own colleague, Jackson Carlow. This amendment adds that provision so that when someone is inquiring about the consequences of getting a GRC, they must tell the register what role that person that they spoke with has and how they know them. This, for example, will be for that person to say that they have spoken with a teacher or a family member or indeed a trusted counsellor or another organisation. Asking for the young person to state who they have spoken to, in my view, is not an onerous ask. It's a sensible one, particularly in comparison to some of the other amendments in this group. But nor should it put a young person off seeking guidance and assistance. In my view, this will strengthen assurances that a young person has accessed much-needed advice and support and carefully considered their application without adding new evidence requirements such as other amendments propose. This amendment has been widely welcomed by a number of stakeholders and organisations. On the balance, when I saw the amendment, my initial thoughts would be that I would support it anyway, because I do feel that it is somewhat of a compromise. But it may be better worded than my own two amendments, which, as my colleague Graham Simpson rightly pointed out, could be subject to the vagaries of legal wrangling thereafter, and that's not something I wanted to achieve. I do want to reflect, though, just briefly I just want to reflect briefly on some comments made by the last speaker, Mr. Kenny Gibson, and I think he is right in saying that there are huge amounts of inconsistencies in the law and socially in how we recognise people of a certain cohort. For example, as I know from my time in the Justice Committee, we do treat the judiciary treats 24 and 25-year-olds differently when it comes, for example, to sentencing guidelines. We ask 16-year-olds to vote for us in elections, but we equally do not afford them the same rights as us for a number of years, nor are they afforded the same repercussions for their actions as people older than them. I've held a long-held view that there are far too many inconsistencies in the application of law or the definition of what a young person actually is, who is it and how old they are, and what rights and responsibilities are afforded on them. Now, that's a much wider debate we certainly don't have time for today, but he is right to point that out. How we square that circle, I think, will be a job for another parliament. The issue, however, on that of the medical intervention that may or may not take place as a result of attending a GRC, and this is where I would like to point out to the Chamber that it has already been possible to obtain a GRC in Scotland for nearly two decades, and at no point does one have to medically transition to the acquired gender in order to receive and use that certificate. So this is something that's already been happening for a very long time. Not everyone who achieves a GRC will go on to transition or will seek medical intervention or be introduced to any form of medication in doing so. That's something that has happened, and that's something that will continue. I'm not convinced that the member made clear that this will be further enhanced or any risk that more people will transition from a medical point of view as part of this new process, this new simplified process. Yes, I believe I had one from Mr. Simpson first and then a colleague.
Graham Simpson.
Can I thank Jamie Green again for taking the intervention? And I appreciate this. He's not speaking to his own amendment, but I'm sure Christine Graham will be very grateful that he's speaking to hers. Again, it comes down to language, I guess. This Amendment 99, which relates to guidance that a young applicant must seek, and the amendment here says the applicant must tell the Registrar General what role the individual mentioned has or how the individual knows the applicant. So we already have in the bill that this advice must be sought. I'm just wondering, and I appreciate it is not Jamie Green's amendment, but if you could give his view on what difference any of that would make to what is already in the bill.
Jamie Green.
So at the moment, the bill in Section 3A states that the young person, just to be correct and accurate on page 2 into page 3, must confirm that the applicant has discussed the implications of obtaining a GRC with an individual who has a role which involves giving guidance, advice or support to young people. That's point A, and I think that was a welcome addition. Point B then goes on to say is at least 18 and knows the applicant personally, both quite helpful and welcome additions. Amendment 99 goes further and adds to that by saying that the Registrar General must be told by the applicant what role the individual mentioned in subsection 2 has, and the reason for that, I suspect, is that others are calling, for example, that that person must be a medical professional, a doctor, a suitably qualified medical professional to give advice alone, and therefore I think limits the scope of what type of person can give that advice, but also importantly how that person knows the individual. Now, I appreciate and I do accept that we could go further, and perhaps with the benefit of time we could have added to this amendment. I probably would have added to it myself had we not had such a deadline. Members will recall we all had extremely tight deadlines to deliver by midday on the Wednesday of last week, feels like a million years ago, but many of us were sitting in other committees and trying to draft amendments at the same time on our mobile phones. It's not ideal. None of this was actually ideal. I think we all need to make progress. None of this was ideal, and I think, yes, you're right, we could have strengthened many of these amendments, but we are where we are on this, and I do feel like it's a sensible compromise, which is why I'm happy to support it. I'm not sure if the other member wanted to intervene still.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Jamie Green for taking the intervention. It was just on an article that had been drawn to my attention in the British Medical Journal, which says that currently 7% of people who apply for a GRC, their application is turned down. So I was wondering, and when Jamie Green was talking there about the medical intervention, the diagnosis of gender dysphoria, which is obviously done by a doctor, do you believe that the Scottish Government must address the people who will be refused a GRC, who were refused a GRC previously by a doctor, who would now be able to obtain a GRC through a self-ID system in Scotland?
Jamie Green.
I'm not 100% understand what the member's asking me, but I'm happy to have a very lengthy discussion about it. I'm not sure it's relevant to this amendment. I think the premise of what's been asked, though, is that those who have been refused their certificate in the past may now be able to apply for one. There are certain individuals, I believe, that are problematic in obtaining a GRC, and we're going to come on in a later group to discuss that very issue, perhaps coming out very shortly in the next group. And yes, I think there are some sensible amendments that we should add to the legislation, which add some further safeguards and protections around a very specific cohort of people. The big point, though, I would say, and it maybe is just simply a point of difference, is that the current process does require a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. I made that very clear in my Stage 1 comments, that that's a concept that I disagreed with, and for all the reasons that are already on the record, Presiding Officer, and that for that reason I would be unwilling to support amendments which sought to reintroduce that medicalisation and that diagnosis of gender dysphoria to the process of obtaining a GRC. That's on the record, and I'm sure members will respect my position on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Green. I now call Jackie Bailey to speak to Amendment 105 and other amendments in the group. Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I do not intend to detain the Chamber for long, but can I start by associating myself with Jamie Green's opening remarks in thanking all the organisations and individuals who have been in touch with us, because that has helped to inform the debate. Could I also thank the legislation team for all their work on amendments, the drafting, then the redrafting as we hone our thinking. And I also want to support amendments in the name of Martin Whitfield, as they are proportionate, sensible and reasonable, and I commend them to the Chamber. But I wish to speak to Amendment 105 in my name, and can I welcome the amendments laid by Christine Graham at Stage 2 of the Bill's consideration, because they have put safeguards into the Bill to ensure that such a significant decision taken by 16 and 17-year-olds is taken with due care and support. I agree with her that a person applying for a gender recognition certificate has to have lived in their acquired gender for a period of 6 months rather than 3. Where my concern lies is that effectively someone aged 15 and a half can start the process in order to obtain the certificate on their 16th birthday. Now, for those who consider 16 is perhaps too young, this merits some reflection by the Parliament. So my amendment effectively says that the 6 months starts on the person's 16th birthday. So I would therefore be grateful for an explanation and indeed reassurance from the Cabinet Secretary in the absence of Christine Graham that they have no concerns that this might be too early and what safeguards they believe are in place to protect and support young people.
Thank you, Ms. Bailey. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. I also want to just start by thanking all the groups that have been in touch with me, and can I also thank all the constituents from across Lothian who have emailed me over the last weeks and months. I'm sure all members have received lots of emails putting very strong arguments on both sides, and although we have to come to a view on this, I do appreciate the time that we have taken to do that. I want to stand briefly, Deputy President Officer, to speak in favour of Amendment 6 in this section. The reason I do that is actually to follow through on what the First Minister said yesterday. In a TV interview, she said these words, "This is a bill that does not give any new rights to trans people." She went on to say to claim that it only affects the process of obtaining a GRC. That would be true if Rachel Hamilton's amendments are approved this afternoon. If they are not, then this does give new rights to trans people, because as the bill stands at the moment, it will reduce the age from 18 to 16. So I think it would be helpful if the Cabinet Secretary is intervening or speaking on these sections to clarify if the First Minister is right that this does give no new rights. But if the First Minister is wrong, can she tell us why these new rights are important, and why did the First Minister make the statement that she did yesterday to the press? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this group. Can I too, like others have done, put on record my thanks to all those organisations and individuals who have worked so hard to get us to this point today. Those who have provided briefings, information, guidance, the parliamentary staff, in committee, the legislation team and others who have supported the passage of this bill through the stages, and of course, trans people themselves who have waited so long for this day. Extending the right to obtain a gender recognition certificate to 16 and 17-year-olds is absolutely the right thing to do. It brings us in line with international good practice, and importantly, it allows us to align this important legislation with the age of legal capacity, which in Scotland is 16. At this age, young people can get married, join the army, work, and vote in Scottish parliamentary and local elections. It's almost as if we trust them to make big life decisions on their own. I do not see why this is any different. Let us also remember that many young people have already socially transitioned by the time they are 16. This might include coming out to their friends and families without applying for a GRC. Not having a birth certificate that matches their identity could cause issues when applying for jobs, further or higher education, and more importantly, leave them open to a lack of privacy regarding their trans status. I have spoken elsewhere about my vehement opposition to any waiting periods, living in the acquired gender and the reflection period. The former was extended to 6 months at stage two for young people. Retaining these time periods in any form means we go against international best practice. There is no evidence for these time periods to exist, and trans people and those who work with them and support them have told us repeatedly that there is no justification for these waiting times. In view of this, we certainly cannot support Jackie Bailey's Amendment 105 that effectively means only trans people aged 16 and a half can apply for a GRC. That makes a mockery of one of the very principles of this bill, of extending it to 16 and 17-year-olds. Changing one's legal gender is not something one does on a whim. Those applying for a GRC will likely have thought about, considered, and reflected on this decision for months, if not years. Let us believe young people when they tell us they know their own minds. let us not pathologise them. Let us be clear that 16 and 17-year-olds should and will be able to get a GRC and be recognised in law for who they are. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Carol Mochan.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I say on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats how grateful we are for all the work that's gone in, both to the production of this bill to get it to this stage and the briefings that we have all received. Can I also state on record how grateful I am for the respectful tone this debate has been conducted with so far. There has been too much heat and hate around this bill, and I'm grateful for colleagues for expressing their remarks and their concerns or their support for the bill with such respect, and I hope we continue in that vein. Deputy Presiding Officer, listening to some of the well-crafted remarks from people who oppose the legislation or oppose it being extended to 16-year-olds, you would be forgiven for thinking that we were somehow pioneers in extending gender recognition or reforming gender recognition in this way. We are not pioneers. We are 7 years behind Ireland in this regard. We are behind the international curve. Right now, 250 million people around the planet live in jurisdictions where gender recognition is obtained through a system of self-identification, and has not led to a correlation to some of the things that we have heard prophesied in the debates against reform or against extending it to 16-year-olds. This Parliament has grappled with the concept of the age of majority since its inception. It did so for the 13 years that I served in the children's voluntary sector, at times when I was participating in trying to influence legislation around exactly that. And it did so in the years before, and it has done in the years since. But over time, I think it's fair to say that we have started to see a natural coalescence around the age of 16 in terms of age of majority. We've heard, I think, some very eloquent speeches from the likes of Maggie Chapman about what capacity we credit 16-year-olds with in our society. But there is still variance. Of course there's still variance. And that's because we are always on a journey. This Parliament is on a never-ending journey in terms of finding the right balance of law. One of such variants I mentioned in my intervention to Rachel Hamilton was around the age of criminal responsibility. That rests now at 12. It was at 8. That is the age at which we credit children, young people, with having the mental capacity to understand the impact of their actions and their decisions. And the Conservatives backed that change to 12. Presiding Officer, if we could credit 16-year-olds with the mental capacity to commit crime, to marry, to serve in our armed forces, then I think it's only right that we credit them to recognise who they are and to want to have that recognised on the documents that we as a state require them to hold. Claire Baker expresses concern around the correlation between this and medical transition. It was a theme picked up by Kenny Gibson. But I refer again to my earlier remarks about the people who have gone before us. This actually is simply a mechanism to have that recognition for the person you are transcribed onto the forms that you're required to hold. Medical transition is an important debate, but it is not this debate. And let's also be clear. This is about changing the law to remove the barriers and the trauma around having a person's gender recognition reflected on those documents that we currently ask of them. And that is real trauma. The GRA is harming people every day, and we cannot allow it to continue where the final decision about your identity is entrusted to strangers that you have never met. Jamie Green, I think, spoke very well and has talked about, I think, in his amendment in 98, I'm not persuaded that the providing evidence of that discussion with an appropriate adult will not create unnecessary barriers to 16-year-olds, but I do support, I think, and he spoke very well in support of the compromise amendment in Christine Graham's name for Amendment 99. So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scottish Liberal Democrats believe that if we credit 16-year-olds with mental capacity to do so many things, life-changing things in our society, then we should have the trust in them and credit them with the mental capacity to understand who they are and to seek to have that recognised in the documents we require them to hold. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. I now call Carol Mochan to be followed by Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In reference to my colleague Claire Baker's Amendment 94, I feel it's important to raise the serious concerns many parents have raised with me and young people have regarding this part of the bill. especially considering how poor current support provision is for young people in this country. This is despite being the group in perhaps greatest need of support. It is essential that young people can access the same level of psychological and social support as any person before making such a decision, and I do not see that this is available at all. My colleague in Amendment 94 is quite rightly asking for a pause to this section of the bill. She raises very well, and clearly this would not prevent 16 or 17-year-olds from socially transitioning. Presiding officer, I can't think of many pieces of transformative legislation that would be passed before something as important as the Cash Review had published its conclusions, which, though not specifically focused on NHS Scotland, can clearly, quite clearly has great relevance here, and we should have the opportunity to consider its findings before we change the age. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I call Ash Regan to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I intend to set out my wider arguments on the bill in Group 13 debate, in which I have some amendments lodged of my own. My general position on the bill is that I'll not be supporting it. However, I am intending to support amendments that I feel increase safeguarding provision. In that vein, I'm happy to support Amendment 6 and also Amendment 15. I don't think that children of the age of 16 is an appropriate age for such what is, I think, what many people would consider to be a very profound change. And I want to take this opportunity to share with the Chamber the view of a mother who wrote to me just a few days ago, and she wanted me to read out her perspective to the members in the Chamber today. And I quote her. My 15-year-old daughter is on the autistic spectrum and is struggling with anxiety and depression. Despite showing no signs of gender incongruence before the age of 12, she self-diagnosed as having gender dysphoria 3 years ago and currently identifies as male. I believe she's been influenced by social media and current societal norms. And the teen years is a time of flux, and how she feels now may change over time as she matures. The school and the NHS have taken an affirmative approach, despite my concerns as a parent. And I don't agree that the government should be lowering the age that young people can self-ID to the age of 16, as socially transitioning is the first step along an often misguided path to medicalisation and surgery. I was persuaded and coerced that it was the right thing to do to call my daughter by the new name and pronouns, when in fact this was bad advice and has led us down a very difficult path as a family. I believe a watchful waiting and holistic approach is best, looking at all the factors in a young person's life. End quotation. There is also a large and increasing number of detransitioner voices, and that's something that I feel has not been well represented in this process. And the detransitioners event that was mentioned earlier today, hosted by Ruth Maguire in the Parliament just a few weeks ago. And I would agree with the other members that have spoken on this so far that their stories were extremely powerful, heartbreaking even. And there was a real strong sense that they had been very much let down by those who should, in fact, have been protecting them. The question was put to them, was self-ID at 16 a good change? It was an emphatic no from the two young people. Neither of them supported self-ID, and they thought that having a bit of paper in your new gender would, in their view, only incentivise young people to seek to change how they looked in order to match up to their new documents. The age should be 18 and no lower, in my view, and in my opinion, we should exercise extreme caution in this area.
Thank you. I now call Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I just wanted to make a short contribution to this debate and also to seek some clarity on a number of points from the Ministers. I'll start by saying that there is considerable public concern about age 16 in the bill, and therefore it is right that it should be the subject of scrutiny
and deep scrutiny. So I'd like to thank all colleagues for their contributions in this regard. We already protect young people who have not reached the age of 18, and I think we'll continue to have those types of debates. I want to thank Jamie Green, Jackie Bailey and Carol Mawkin and Ash Denham for bringing important contributions to the debate, but also on the importance of supporting young people. I think it's an important principle wherever you vote at the end of the day. I think it's not inconsistent at all with recognising the independence of young people at 16. I think it's important to note, and I will continue to talk about this as we go on through the passage of these groupings, that the model of the proposed legislation being a self-ID model, whereas the 2004 legislation had many other requirements, including a period of 2 years where documents are changed over that period. So I think it's quite important to recognise the substantial difference in having a GRC under 2004 and 2022. Here are the areas that I'd like some clarity on from the government. So many constituents and LGBT constituents have said to me that they cannot, when they apply for college, they want to make sure that the birth certificate aligns with their gender. But I'm a bit unclear about whether colleges are actually asking for that. And I'm advised that they can ask for other documents. I think it'd be important to clarify that particular point. Also, I think the government needs to be clear about why arguing for the UN rights of the child being 18. It's a very important point for the government to address, not anyone else, as to why they've gone for 16. And I will be listening very carefully to that answer. And finally, as Claire Baker has outlined and others have, there is a very, very important review on the table by Dr. Cass. I'm not clear why the government has not seemed to be listening to the pleas of Dr. Cass to halt this particular provision, at least on time. So that seems to kind of be a sensible place to be, at least until that is reviewed. So these are the areas that I would like clarity on before I make my final decision. I would be very grateful to hear it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McNeill. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to respond to these amendments.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin, like others, by thanking everyone who has helped us get to this stage of the bill and also for the constructive tone that has been set so far. 2 months ago at stage one, the principles of this bill were agreed by a strong majority in this chamber with support from members of all parties. Following that and ahead of stage two, I undertook meetings with many MSPs from across this chamber. Wherever possible, we worked constructively together to agree amendments to strengthen the bill at stage two, and as a result, more amendments were voted in at stage two than were voted down. 47 were agreed, 43 were not agreed, and 60 were not moved. I have again met with any member who requested it ahead of stage three, and again have been able to agree some positive changes to the bill that are consistent with those principles that were agreed at stage one. And I'm grateful to members of all parties for working with me on improvements to the bill. Yes, of course.
Fergus Ewing.
I very much welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comment about tone and the involvement of all members. But could I ask her to respond directly to a point that was made, albeit briefly, by Rachel Hamilton in her opening remarks? Namely, that whereas there may be one view here, and even a majority here, that all the evidence of the views of the people of Scotland, as recorded in poll after poll, records the view, incontrovertibly, that a very substantial majority of people in Scotland, ranging from 68 to 81%, oppose the reduction of the age to 16.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say to Fergus Ewing that there have been many consultations and polls that we could point to. I could point to the two large public consultations at the start of this bill process, which of course showed support. I could point to the BBC poll conducted earlier this year that showed support for this bill, particularly among women, actually, and support for reducing the age to 16. But I do acknowledge to Fergus Ewing and others that there is a difference of opinion about this bill. There has been from the start. there is a difference of opinion about age. There has been from the start, and I think I said when I opened at stage one that actually the issue of age had been one of the most difficult to address because of all the issues that members have raised, and I took a lot of time to consider those issues. And of course, listening to the views of young people themselves has also been an important part of that. And young people have said very clearly that they believe they should have the ability to be able to make those decisions. And I'll go on to say a bit more about that in terms of the age of legal capacity in a moment. The amendments that I have worked with members on include amendments tabled by Christine Graham at stage two, which I supported, and of course her amendment 99 today. The extension of legal gender recognition to those aged 16 and 17 with appropriate safeguards is of course one of the principles that the Equalities Committee showed clear support for in its stage one report. And this is an area strengthened at stage two. However, there are amendments in this group that we cannot support. Amendments 6 to 9 and 12 in the name of Rachel Hamilton seek to revert the minimum age of application back to 18, and therefore I cannot support them. Amendments 93, yes, of course.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. Would the Cabinet Secretary accept that accepting Christine Graham's amendments, which give further support for under-18s, means that the government are accepting that lowering the age is a problem?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I accept is I've listened to concerns that have been raised and the need for young people aged 16, 17 to have that additional support. And that is why we've set out and agreed to the amendments at stage two and are supporting the amendments at stage three, which are around making sure the young person understands the process and that they have sought and undertaken appropriate support. I think that is the right balance to making sure that young people are afforded the same rights, but in recognition of their age, are given that additional support. And I think that strikes the right balance in this bill. Yes.
Emma Roddick.
Secretary, for taking this intervention. I just wanted to recognise for a moment that a young man did have his identity challenged in the Scottish Parliament moments ago, and I wonder if she would agree that that is wrong and offer support to him in something that should never have happened.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm not aware of the details of what Emma Roddick is raising, but someone's details should never be revealed at all, and that certainly I would agree on the basis of what Emma Roddick has just told me with that. Amendments 93 and 94 in the name of Claire Baker provide that the minimum age of applicant should be 18 until such time as the CAST review has published its final report. Now, given, and I've said this on a number of occasions, there's no link between the outcome of the CAST review of NHS England provision of medical services and this bill, which is about trans people obtaining legal gender recognition in Scotland, I cannot support those amendments. Yes, of course.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. It would be helpful if the Cabinet Secretary, the Stage 1 report from the Equalities Committee did ask if the Government would undertake a review into gender identity healthcare. It would be helpful to know if that was the Government's intention. And I think there are areas in the CAST review, principally that there are an increasing number of young women who decide to go through this process. Do you feel the Government has a proper understanding of what the reasons for that are as we're looking at extending this right to 16-year-olds?
Cabinet Secretary.
So on the issue of the CAST review, and of course it's important to recognise that the service model in England is still providing the services, just on a different model, in a regionalised model. And we've continued to say, and of course it's the health ministers that are in the lead to this, but we've continued to state that we will closely consider the findings of the CAST review in the context of our work to improve NHS Scotland service provision, and I think it's important to do that. I think I should also make the point that within those health services, those are multi-professional health services, so they do have links to mental health services, to CAMHS and other supports to look at the young person in the round. And I think that hopefully will give some reassurance to some of the points that have been made on that. The effect of Amendment 105 in the name of Jackie Bailey would be that the minimum age for an applicant would be 16 years and 6 months instead of 16. And I think setting a minimum age of 16 and a half would be confusing. And of course, the principle of the bill is that someone will declare that they have been living in the acquired gender, and for young people that will be for 6 months. But of course, it's a retrospective look and commitment and declaration of the fact that they have been living in their acquired gender. Yes.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, and I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary. I think I was looking for reassurance about what safeguards she thought there would be in place if somebody was applying at the quite young age of 15 and a half.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the person can only apply from 16 onwards. They can't apply at 15 and a half. They can only apply from 16. And I think the safeguards, as we have already been talking about, are there around making sure, first of all, that the young person understands the process and that the commitment they are signing up to and committing to, and that also they are able to say what support they have received and from whom. Now, obviously, there are other amendments I'll come on to in a second about some of the detail of that. But it's been clear to me in listening to young trans people that they do feel excluded from a system to access legal gender recognition, particularly at an age where a young person will want to have consistent documentation before moving on to higher and further education or starting the first job. Now, I take Claire Baker's point, I think it was Claire Baker, about whether it's colleges or universities that are asking for particular documentation, but it's young people themselves that are saying that they want to be able to get on with their life with all of the documentation reflecting who they are and how they're living their life. And I don't think that's an unreasonable thing to ask for. Young people in Scotland are empowered at 16 to leave home without parental consent, to get a full-time job, pay national insurance, enter into a legally binding contract, consent to medical procedures, to marry, change their name and vote for members of this Parliament. And whilst, of course, it is possible, as others have done, to point to comparators for what you can and cannot do at specified ages, applying for legal gender recognition generally aligns with the other comparable rights and responsibilities young people obtain at 16. It aligns with the provisions in the Age of Legal Capacity Scotland Act 1991, where under Scots law, a person of or over the age of 16 generally has legal capacity to enter into any transaction having legal effect. I will not be supporting Amendments 98 and 101 in the name of Jamie Green, which provides that a 16 or 17-year-old applicant must provide evidence of the support that they have sought if requested, as it's not clear how a young person would evidence conversations that they've had if required to do so. For example, would there have to be a record of a personal conversation they've had with a family member or with a trusted organisation or a counselling service, for example? I also can support amendments in the name of Martin Whitfield, which require the young person to provide the name and contact details of the person they have sought support from. A teacher, counsellor or doctor or organisation that provides support to young people should not expect to be approached by a staff member from National Records of Scotland asking about confidential conversations that they've had with a young person. I'd also point out that the bill already includes provision to allow a GRC to be refused or revoked for applicants of any age on the grounds of incapacity. As the Registrar General explained in evidence to the committee, it's not for NRS to make a judgment about the capacity of an applicant. If they have concerns, they'll apply to a sheriff, and it is they who can determine whether a person has capacity based on evidence. And I hope that gives Martin Whitfield the assurance that he is looking for. Yeah, on you go.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary giving way. And so it is right to say that the bill as it exists will provide that power to the Registrar General, albeit the Registrar General is not the person who will undertake the assessment as to capacity. That would be a court, rightly so. But the provision is there where a registrar is uncertain, but on the assumption that there is capacity to begin with.
Cabinet Secretary.
Correct. And the Sheriff, of course, would have the ability to make further inquiries and look at the evidence. Registrar General doesn't have that, but they are able to raise those concerns if they have concerns about capacity. I also cannot support Amendment 15 in the name of Kenny Gibson that requires that the support to the young person must be from someone suitably qualified. In many cases, such support will be best provided by a supportive family member, for example. I do support Amendment 99 in the name of Christine Graham, which provides that when confirming to the Registrar General that they have discussed their application with a suitable individual, the young person must provide their role or how they know them. And I think this will strengthen the assurance that a young applicant has accessed advice or support and carefully considered their application without introducing new evidence requirements. And with this in place, those of Martin Whitfield and others, I don't believe, are needed. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Rachel Hamilton to wind up and to speak or withdraw Amendment 6.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My position on allowing children to apply for a gender recognition certificate has been clear from stage one of the bill. As with so much of this bill, these provisions leave an abundance of unanswered questions. The government, I believe, is deeply confused about the definition of a child. It cannot explain why it believes the CAS review has no relevance to this part of the bill. It cannot guarantee that it won't lower the age at which someone can obtain a GRC even further. It cannot explain how these provisions would interact with the educational provisions within the 2010 Equality Act. And relying on the assertions from the Scottish Government organisations to reassure them that this is all right does not make it all right. The holes in this part of the bill are glaring, and they are there for all of us to see. That we are having these conversations around extra safeguards is an admission that members in this chamber are concerned. And I would urge members to carefully consider my arguments that I've set out as to why maintaining the status quo for the age is important. Amendments and comments from my colleagues in the Chamber have raised significant points, especially the arguments made by Claire Baker, Pauline McNeill, Kenny Gibson and Ash Reagan. But if we keep the status quo on the age... Yes?
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the member for taking an intervention on that point. Does Rachel Hamilton think it's wrong to weaponise neurodiversity and neurodivergent young people in this way, in this debate, and say that they are incapable of making decisions for themselves?
Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I'm very disappointed in Maggie Chapman's intervention. I think it's absolutely disgraceful to lower the tone of this very respectful debate that we're all having today. We have a right to speak about our concerns in this chamber from any party. Anyone can speak freely and openly. And if we don't have a robust debate on this, we cannot make good legislation, and that is a problem in this Parliament.
Daniel Johnson.
While I'm grateful to the member for giving way, and while I am very understanding of why the member has concerns about the way that neurodivergent people may be being discussed, can I say, as a neurodivergent person, that it's incredibly important that we think through this very carefully. And I have someone with a neurodevelopmental disorder, who is neurodivergent in some other way, may be approaching this issue if they are transgender, and it's important that we think through that very carefully indeed.
Rachel.
I think Daniel Johnson makes a very important point, Presiding Officer, and one of my own family members is neurodivergent, so please don't ever intervene in that manner again, Maggie Chapman, because it is very upsetting from a personal point of view. No. No, thank you.
The member has made clear she's not taking an intervention. Rachel Hamilton.
So I would urge members to consider the arguments that I have made, and I think that we should look at this very, very carefully in light of the unanswered questions I asked the Cabinet Secretary to address, and the fact that they have supported Christine Graham's amendment, which actually looks at giving support to lowering the age, and that happened at stage two. So they're clearly, the Scottish Government have an issue with lowering the age, and they have understood that two-thirds of the Scottish public disagree with lowering the age, as my colleague has already highlighted. But, Presiding Officer, I have no more to add, and I move the amendments in my name. Thank you.
Press the amendment. Ms Hamilton, you already moved it, so just press it.
Thank you.
Very much. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. As this is the first division of the stage, the Parliament is suspended for 5 minutes.